was holding he would come, and the rings he would on it play on an old rugged cross. Then they laid him in the tomb. How the Lord went in that room. Now church is coming back someday to take us home with him to stay there forever. In glory we will share. And when the first trumpet sounds, we will all be glory bound. Up there we'll live forever.
There is no Genesis chapter 3 and verse number 9. And I want to talk to you tonight on a simple subject, and that subject is when God comes calling. When God comes calling, there's always a reason when God shows up on the scene. It's never just a casual visit. It's never just that he's passing by and wants to stop in. God's always got a purpose for everything that he does. And when you look in chapter number 3, verse number 9, you notice the Bible said this, "And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou?" Where art thou? When God comes calling, there are three things in particular that he seeks. Number one, he's seeking recognition. He wants you and I to know that it's God. Amen? I don't know about you, but when I come to the house of God, I want to hear God's voice. I want God to speak to me. And I know since I'm saved that I'm going to be able to recognize the voice of God. It's a familiar voice. When God begins to move, I feel good about it. It's when he doesn't move and I can't hear him and I don't know that he's there that I start getting worried about things. Yeah. But God came calling so that he might be recognized. The Bible said it was in the cool of the day that he would come. But something on this day was very different from all the other days when God come calling. Not only does he want recognition, but he wants receptiveness. God wants to be received when he comes calling. Amen? When God enters in, he wants hearts to be opened unto him so that you and I might receive the best and the blessings of Almighty God. The problem with Adam and Eve that day, as all of us know, is that there was something in their heart that wasn't right. And instead of running to God, they ran away from God. They didn't want to meet with God. In fact, they hid themselves from God. Hey, I want to tell you, when God comes looking for you, God's going to find you. There's no question about that. You can't hide from God. There's not a place on this earth, there's not a place in the heavens or beneath the earth that God can't find where you are at. There's no question about that. There are a lot of people that get out of church and they run away from God and they think, well, you know, if I just don't go back, maybe God will leave me alone. Wrong. God don't leave you alone. If you've ever been saved by the grace of God, God loves his children. And God's going to come. There's no question about that. If you haven't been saved, I can assure you that he came to seek and save that which is lost. So he won't leave you alone either. Amen? And I can never forget when my dad was before he got saved, there were many people that used to come from our church, Haines Baptist Church. We lived in the village there, and they'd come and they'd try to witness to Dad, and Dad a lot of times would either run and sit in the bathroom or he'd make his way out the back door and he'd run and hide and he'd go down the woods. He'd do everything he could to get away from those guys. And a lot of times he did get away from them, but he never got away from God. And one day God came calling and he had to answer, amen? And I praise the Lord for that. But also when he comes, he wants a response. He wants you and I to respond to him. We ought to let God know that we're appreciative when God shows up. We ought to let God know that we're thankful that God cares enough about us that he would come and even recognize us and even care for us or even love us or even want to associate with us. What a blessing it is that God would want to do that. And I praise God for that. But I wrote down some things that I want to share with you tonight. When God comes calling, that I hope will be a blessing to you. Number one, perversion is revealed. There's no question about it. When God comes on the scene, God is not going to put up with the sin of mankind. When God comes on the scene, God recognizes and realizes the wrongs of our life. And may I say this, every single one of us that are in this building tonight is a sinner. There's no doubt about it. We're all sinners. We were born into sin. From our mother's wombs, we came into sin. But thank God there was a day when the most of us that are in here tonight, and hopefully all of us that are in here tonight, got saved by the grace of God. We are still sinners, but we are sinners saved by grace. Amen? And I praise God for that. But let me tell you something about what God will do. God will come, and when he comes calling, he'll recognize the sins that are in our heart and in our lives. Sometimes we think we can hide them from God. Sometimes we think we can do things and God doesn't see. Old Belshazzar thought that back in Daniel chapter number 5. His dad, Nebuchadnezzar, had stolen the golden and silver vessels from the temple of the house of God. And he thought to himself, well, I'm just going to throw a big party and we're going to have a great time and God won't know anything about it. We're going to bring out those temple vessels and we're going to pour our liquor and our wine in it. We're going to get drunk. We're just going to have a great time. And God will never know. But as they begin their party, that night there came a man's hand in on the ceiling of the building. And that man began to write the doom of those people that were in that party that night. I want you to understand, you don't hide away from God. You don't get away from God. Your sins don't escape the eyes of God. God knows all about it. And God will one day come calling without a doubt. Sometimes when you least expect it, God is going to show up. The Bible said Belshazzar's knees began to smote against one another. He became so fearful when he saw that God knew exactly what God was doing. I don't understand some people because they think God never knows anything about my life. But I want to tell you something tonight. God knows all things about your life. All things about your life. There's no use in trying to be secretive about anything because God sees all things. And you and I have to realize that. And we have to know that. And I want to tell you something else. God comes calling in times of unfaithfulness to God. I'm not talking about unfaithfulness to a husband or a wife. I'm talking about unfaithfulness to the house of God, unfaithfulness to the call of God, unfaithfulness to the calls of the Almighty God. God will call upon us when we get lax and we feel like, well, somebody else can always do the job. Somebody else should do the job. It may be true, but God saved you. Amen. God saved you. And God didn't just save you to give you a good seat in a nice, pretty church. God saved you to serve him and to be a voice for God and to let people know that God still saves old sinners. Amen. What a blessing that is. But not only that, he will call out the sins of ungodliness. There's no question about it. I'm surprised because we live in a day and a time when sin has become so prevalent in our world that people think they can get away with anything. The politicians think they can do anything. The president thinks he can just say, well, we're no longer a Christian nation, so we're going to just rush God out the door. You don't just push God out the door. God made this place. God put breath into your life and into my life. God is here. God understands. And you and I've got to know that. And we see today that sin is slipping into the churches and churches are doing things like we've never seen before, ungodly acts, and yet they think it's okay. But I want to tell you, what God called sin many years ago is still sin today. And God will have those who sin against him answer for the sins that they have committed. There's no question about that. And we need to recognize that as well. But then there's also sins of unbelief. Sins of unbelief. And may I say that's not always for sinners. There's a lot of God's children that won't believe God. There's a lot of God's children that won't trust God. They won't give to God what God asks for. They don't want to do for God what God wants them to do. They just will not believe God. And won't believe God. But I want to say to you tonight, the best thing you'll ever do is put your faith and your trust in the Almighty God. And believe that God can and God will do anything and all things. And may I say to you tonight, he certainly will. There is no question about that. You're looking at a man who's experienced it many times. Many times I thought that God had forgotten me. Many times I thought God has forsaken me. Many times I thought God has given up on me. But every single time God came and proved himself that he still cares and that he still loves us and that we belong to him, and he promised to watch after us and he promised to meet every need of our life, and he's never yet broken one of his promises. Amen. What a tremendous blessing that is. But there are times when God comes calling, and when he does, the powers are broken. Amen. I don't know about you, but I'm glad that there is one that's stronger than old Satan. I'm glad that the demons of hell don't have to rule and reign in our hearts and in our lives and keep us down and out all the time. Amen. I know without a doubt that the devil is having a heyday in this day and time. I know that in most churches he's beat them down. I know that he's separated the fellowship. I know that without a doubt there are people that are angry with one another. I know that people get upset when the preacher preaches things that they don't like. But I want to tell you something tonight. God's able to break the powers of Satan. There's no question about that. God is greater than him. And I'm thankful for that. If you remember a man by the name of Legion, the Word of God said that he was filled with devils. But there was a man by the name of Jesus that happened by his way one day. And old Legion met him, praise God. And out of Legion was cast all of those demons, all of those devils, that power of domination that Satan had upon his life was just destroyed by the power of the Son of God. Amen. You and I know well in our own lives when the days when Satan had control of us as well. I mean, it may have been drugs, it may have been alcohol. I don't know what it might have been, but there was a satanic power that had control of you and I. But aren't you glad for the day, thank God, when Jesus showed up and took away those desires and took away that filth and took away that wrong out of your life and made you a creature that was his very own. He called you his son. He saved you by his grace. He washed you in his precious blood. And you and I ought to be thankful tonight for the power of God. Amen. I'm glad that God comes calling and he breaks the power of satanic domination. He also breaks the power of severe delirium as well. The Bible said that same man was out of his mind. He'd go and he would cry. He'd do crazy things. Hey, I want to tell you something. That's exactly where Satan wants all of us tonight. Your mind is the playground of Satan. There's no question about that. I've been there. I know exactly what I'm talking about. If he can enter your mind and convince you that God don't care, that people don't care, nobody's praying for you, nobody gives a hoot about you, nobody's concerned about your needs, then he'll convince you and he'll defeat you. And here was a man that was out of his mind. He was as crazy could be. But the Bible said after Jesus came, they walked by, and there sat that man at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. Amen. Aren't you glad that God can change your mind? When it looks like the mountain's too big, God can bring that mountain down. When it looks like the valley's too wide to cross, God can make that valley just a stepping stone over. I want to tell you something. God can take the impossible and make it possible. God can take those things which are your greatest fears and help you to have the greatest victories you've ever experienced. There's no question about that. And I praise God for that as well. But not only that, we can also see that powers of self-destruction are broken. You know what happens to most Christians today? The fact that they just don't want to serve God has nothing to do with other people. Although most of the time, they want to blame somebody else. It's really themselves. They're destroying themselves. They're convinced within themselves that they are unworthy to be called a child of God, that they are unworthy for a church like this, that they just don't deserve any good thing from God. And so they go on to destroy themselves. But here was a man, the Bible said, that in the tombs in the night would cut himself and scream and cry out. But when Jesus came on the scene, the cutting stopped. The crying in the middle of the night stopped. The craziness stopped, praise God. Hey, I want to tell you something. Jesus mended him more than just in his soul alone. He mended him in his mind and in his physical body. I want to tell you something. God can do great things and mighty things if we only allow him to do so. God can do it. There's no question about that. But then I also want to say this. When God comes calling, prisons are opened. Amen? Amen. Prisons are open. Prisons of slavery. There's no doubt about it. Old Satan likes to make slaves out of all of us. No question about that. But aren't you glad for the day that Jesus came by and opened that prison door for you and set you free? Hallelujah. Aren't you glad for that day? Just like old Peter when he was in the prison and there came the earthquake and he got to walk out. Paul and Silas in the prison. The earthquake came. He got to walk out. Hey, I want to tell you something. The power of God can open any prison door and let you out and set you free to serve the Master in a way that only God wants you to. You can do that. There's no question about that. Prison, not only of slavery, but of sadness as well. A lot of Christians are so sad today. And I understand why, because it's a difficult day. But we ought not to be surprised, because the Bible plainly says, as the days go on, things are not going to get better. They're going to get worse. We heard a president stand up 4 years ago, 6 years ago, and promise America, everything's going to get better. It's all going to get better. And everybody's going to be all right. But it just hasn't panned out, has it? But let me say this. I don't care who it is. I don't care if it's Republican, Democrat, Independent, or whatever. Whatever man stands in the presidency of the United States is not going to be able to solve all of your problems. But I know one that can. And he sits higher than the president. In fact, he's sitting on the throne tonight, and he knows everything's going to be all right. And I know everything's going to be all right because I've done read the back of the book, praise God. And in the end, you and I are winners. Amen. Hallelujah. And that's a tremendous blessing. And I praise God for that. But not only that, the prison doors of shame as well. Yeah. Amen. Sometimes we're all human. And sometimes we realize that we do things wrong. And as a result of that, we allow shame to take over our life. We feel the guilt and the things that we've let down, not only God's preacher and God's people, but God himself. And the shame sets in and we think, well, God just can't do anything with my life anymore. There's just no way that God will be able to help me. But may I say tonight, God will help you. God can help you. God wants to help you. And God will be there for you. May I say, this preacher or me or any other preacher that's in this building, any other Christian that's in this building, may make all kinds of promises to try to do our best to help you in every situation of life. But there's really only one that can. And he's God of glory tonight. And he will, praise God. He will. What a blessing that is. When God comes calling, peril is stayed. Amen? I'm glad God takes us out of danger's way, aren't you? I'm glad he does. Because I realize that without a doubt, the one thing Satan wants to do is to destroy our lives. There's no question about that. He's looking to wreck you. He does not want you to have joy. He don't want you to have peace. He don't want you to come to church and say amen. He don't want you to come to church and lift your hand. He don't want you shouting. He don't want you praising God. He don't want you singing happily from your heart. He wants you living miserably. You know why? Because he's miserable. He knows what lies ahead for him. There's no escaping where Satan's going to be going one day. And he's not going to get out of it. One of these days, praise God, the angels of God are going to wrap him up and tie him up and cast him into the lake of fire, and he'll be gone forever. Hallelujah. And when he's gone, you and I are going to be with Jesus, and we also will be with him forever, and we'll be praising God forever. What a day that's going to be. What a day that's going to be. But I feel sorry for some Christians, because some Christians still think that though we're saved and though we're saved forever, there's got to be something that we have to go through. We just got to pay some way. They just don't realize when Jesus died and shed his blood on Calvary, he paid the final cost. He paid it in full. Some Christians today think, well, we're going to have to go through part of the tribulation, maybe the first part or a little bit of it, or we may even have to go all the way to the end. Well, I want to tell you something. I'm not going through one moment of it. If that's what you want, pray, and maybe God will let you do it. But I'm not going to be there. Amen. And I read in the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse number 9, where the Bible says, for God hath not appointed us to wrath. Amen. The judgment of God was settled on the day that I knelt at that old-fashioned altar and gave my heart and my life to Jesus Christ, got saved by the amazing grace of God, and thank God I'll never see wrath one day in my life. Never. Yes, sir. I won't have to go through the judgment of this world. I won't know what those 7 years of tribulation are like. Because I'll be sitting up in heaven at the marriage supper of the Lamb, feasting on the goodness of God. Hallelujah. What a blessing. And I praise God for that. And may I help you to understand tonight, were it not for God, every stinking one of us that are in this building tonight would be going through hell on earth. But thank God for a Savior who cares enough for us that he promised us, though it wouldn't always be a bed of roses, it's still the best life you've ever lived. Amen. And nothing compares to being saved by the grace of God. Last of all, I want to say, when God comes calling, parting is ended. Parting is ended. It was a sad situation, no doubt about it. Adam and Eve had sinned and done wrong against God. They had hid and separated themselves from the only one that cared anything about them. They didn't want to see him. But aren't you glad God is good enough that in spite of all of our failures and the wrongs of our life, he keeps on looking till he finds us. God came calling. And when God comes calling, he's not going to leave till he gets an answer. He's not just going to yell a few times and call your name and then disappear. God don't do that. Some might. Some might give up on you. Some might say, well, there's no hope for them. Some might say, well, they've gone way too far, so there's no use. But I want to tell you what God will do. God just keep calling till you come out from your hiding. And after a while, Adam and Eve came walking out. And you know the story that's there. But I don't want to tell you the sadness of that story. I want to tell you the goodness of that story. The parting ended that day. God welcomed them into his sight. Even though he knew before he ever came that afternoon in the cool of the evening to meet with them, he already knew what they had done wrong. Yet he still wanted to be with them. And he wanted them to be with him. Can I tell you tonight, there's coming the day, praise God, in spite of all we've done or have not done, in spite of all we've been or have not been, there's going to come a day when he steps out on the clouds of glory and he shouts out to the church, come up hither, amen, because he wants to be with us and he wants us to be with him, amen. What a day that's going to be. What a day that's going to be. All parting is going to end. The first time God came calling, he came calling to acquaint man with his sin and wrongdoing. The last time God comes calling, he'll come calling to unite man with his soul's only Savior forever and forever. What a day, what a day that'll be. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight for the privilege of preaching, and I pray that you'll use the message for your honor and glory. I ask you, Lord, tonight that you'll help us realize that God still cares about us. He's still seeking for us. Even though we think we've hid ourselves from God and God don't know what's going on, God knows exactly where we are, and he cares enough to come and find us and fix whatever's wrong in our life for his honor and glory. Lord, we thank you for that tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Brother Jason's going to come and give the invitation. If God spoke into your heart tonight, I hope you'll come.
As the pastor, I want to thank you for viewing our video today. However, if God's dealt with your heart, we do not want to end this video without giving you a chance to be able to accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior. If you're there today and God's actually dealing with your heart, I want to remind you what the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That means every single one of us has had problems, issues, sin, failures, faults in our past. The great thing is this, is that Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh through the Father but by me. There is a way to be able to have hope, to have eternal security within the Lord Jesus Christ, to be able to know that you're saved by the grace of God. Now, the great thing about the Bible is it tells us about the love of God. He says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And that's amazing to a lot of people, and they can quote it. But the beauty of it is this, is the very next verse tells us the purpose of Christ. Because the Bible says, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. That means that God sent his Son to die for those of us who are sinners so that we can have fellowship with God himself. Now, if you're there today and God's really been dealing with your heart, I want to ask you this question. Do you really believe that God's been dealing with you about salvation? If that's the case today, then I want to tell you what you need to do is repent of your sins. You need to die to yourself. Admit that you're lost and you're on your way to hell. And then look at what the Bible tells us, that he tells us that we can be saved through Christ. Who do you call on? There's only one. As the Bible says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. It's only through Christ and Christ alone. So I tell you today, would you trust in Christ? I want to ask you, would you trust in him as a personal Savior? You say, Brother Jason, I don't really know if I can do that. Well, let me tell you, the Bible also tells us that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It don't matter who you are, where you come from. God sent his Son to die for everyone. If you've made this decision today to be able to trust in Christ, to be able to die to yourself, to be able to start living for Christ and accept him as a personal Savior after repenting, would you do us a favor and be able to contact us at 336-788-0551 and let us know about this decision that you made so we can start praying for you. Thank you so much.